Well, good morning. I'd like to welcome and introduce Dr. Robert Murphy, the Executive Director of the Institute for Global Health and the John Philip Fair Professor of Infectious Diseases here at Northwestern Feinberg School of Medicine, who will be answering your COVID questions each Tuesday and Thursday here on the Institute for Global Health's Facebook page. And we invite you to submit any questions you may have pertaining to COVID-19 via Facebook at NU Institute for Global Health, or directly by email at globalhealthinstitute@northwestern.edu. So leading the discussion today, I'm thrilled to introduce Katie, who is an intern this summer with the Institute. So Katie, I now turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Kristen, and welcome everyone who is watching. We're going to start off quickly with looking at some of the most recent COVID headlines, and we are going to start with the question, are the current vaccines effective against the new COVID variants?
Well, this is some good news that we have to share with everyone. There's been a lot of interest in this particular topic. Are our vaccines working? And the good news is that they are. Now, they may not prevent infection like they do with some of the other variants, but they prevent disease. They prevent especially severe disease, hospitalization, and death. So it's very good news, and that's all the variants that have been identified so far, including Delta.
That's great. And Dr. Murphy, do you think that we'll have to get some sort of COVID vaccine annually?
Well, that remains to be seen. So there's basically two things going on. One is that we do see antibody levels that your body makes to these vaccines. We do see them kind of decline over time. But there's another whole part of the immune system, the cellular immune system, that appears to remain quite strong even over time. So we don't know. We'll start seeing if people really break through and get sick or whatever, or if one of these variants really escapes the protection that the vaccine offers. So it really remains to be seen. We don't know if and when a booster is going to be necessary. The prevailing guesses, and there are strictly just guesses, are that we're going to need a booster. The other thing that is going to be a little bit different now is that if you do not have an immune suppressing condition, you don't have cancer, you're not on steroids, you know, otherwise your health is pretty good, you may not need the booster. But there may be a subset of the population, approximately 6% of people have some kind of immunocompromised condition, or it could even be related to age, people over 65 or 70 or 80, or we don't know what the cutoff would be. They may need a booster. So, you know, all that has to play out, but it's of course of an intense research interest, and we'll figure this out at some particular point.
Great. And how far have we seen variants like Delta spread thus far?
Delta is the amount of Delta in the United States, and we're not tracking enough, but we're getting better. Excuse me. It's doubling approximately every 10 days. This is terrible. It's most likely that Delta will take over all the infections or almost all the infections in the United States within the next 2 months, very similar to what it did in the United Kingdom. It comes in. It's so much more transmissible. It just takes over.
Wow. And now switching gears to some of our viewer submitted questions, we're going to start off with a woman who was asking about her 12-year-old granddaughter who recently received her first dose of the Pfizer vaccine and 3 days following was showing hives on her body, specifically her knees. Is that a common side effect that we're seeing?
That's not a common side effect. Typically, if you're going to get hives, usually it's around the injection site. It occurs earlier than 3 days. 3 days, especially on the knees, you know, she could have come in contact with something else. Her immune system's a little revved up. I don't know. She should have the second dose, but just because but the fact that she had hives, I would say that the second dose should be given in a clinical facility. Not a walk-in place or a place that you drive through, just in case there is another reaction like this.
Great. We have a few questions for the safety of church choirs. Should staff still make contact tracing lists and take temperatures?
Well, the guidelines really tell us now that if you're fully vaccinated, you really don't have to do anything unusual. You don't have to wear masks to socially distance or anything. You can be in choir practice, you can do whatever. If there are unvaccinated people involved, either in the audience or in the choir itself, or the choir director or somebody in the choir, you know, that is not gonna work for that person. And you would, that person would, how can you sing with a mask on? You know, so it's not gonna really work too well. So yeah, it only works if everybody is vaccinated. As far as contact tracing and everything, supposedly if you're really vaccinated, you don't have to do any of that that stuff anymore.
And if the full choir is vaccinated, are they allowed to share microphones as well?
Yeah, it's the same thing. It's, they can, they'll be sharing everything. So remember, choir practice is a very high risk activity if you are unvaccinated. The case goes back to a choir in Washington State early in 2020. And after the choir practice, it was over, I can't remember the exact number, but it was over half the people got infected.
Wow.
Yeah.
Another submitted question we have is, if a person was fully vaccinated in February, is it safe for them to attend an indoor concert in August?
Well, there's still some reluctance by the CDC to, you know, sort of recommend that people can go to these mass venues. However, if the venue is checking for vaccination status, that would make it a lot more safe. I think the Lollapalooza concert here in Chicago, I believe they're going to be asking for vaccination status. And so I think that would be okay if they're really doing that. But in many other venues, they don't ask. And some states actually don't even allow them to ask. So that's going to be higher risk. Now remember, the risk is really on the unvaccinated that are attending. The fully vaccinated people, although they can get infected and get very mild disease and then maybe transmit it, but it's a very low even transmission if they get it, even while they're vaccinated. So it's basically, you know, it's up to the person if they want to go to some big event that's not checking for vaccination status.
Okay, good to know. Why are the new COVID variants so much easier to catch?
Yeah, the viruses are mutating constantly. This is expected, this is nature. And they are going to mutate to become actually more efficient animals. Or not animals, the viruses, but I mean, they're gonna mutate and they're gonna become stronger. They could actually mutate and become weaker. I mean, but typically it's gonna be the stronger ones will out-compete whatever is out there in the population. So it's just nature taking its course. Now, if it out-competes and kills everybody, you know, then it's not gonna survive. So it has to, you know, nature reaches a medium that, you know, it is where it all ends up. And all these pandemics and influenza pandemics and this pandemic all come in these like big waves. And ultimately, for a variety of reasons, it goes away. So, you know, hopefully with all the vaccinations and just the nature of the beast, this thing will burn out at some particular point.
Wow. Well, we can hope for that. We have another question wondering if a patient has low platelets, are they high risk for getting the vaccine or is it still safe for them?
Well, this is true for any kind of a person with low platelet count, which is called thrombocytopenia, getting any kind of injection from anything. And so, you know, they should be used to this really already. You know, they must have received some vaccine before. So typically if the number is above 20,000 platelets per ml, they generally do okay. You know, you don't want to be rubbing the area after, you know, kind of common sense things like that. And if it's below 20,000, they need to work with their doctor on how it, is there a safe way to do it? And there are safe ways to do it, but that's going to be between the physician and the patient.
Great. If a person has Hashimoto's disease or another thyroid condition, is that then safe for them to get the COVID vaccine?
Yeah. It turns out, you know, there's been 3 billion people in the world have received at least one dose of the vaccine, all sorts of vaccines all over the place. And, you know, over 100 million in the United States. And many of them had diseases like Hashimoto's or other autoimmune diseases. As a matter of fact, there have not been really any reports of vaccine-related problems in this patient group. So that's good news.
Great. And generally, if someone has celiac disease or both Hashimoto's and celiac, would it be safe for them to get the vaccine as well?
Well, it's the same thing with that. It's kind of those two things really go together. They're different types of immune type disorders. And the International Celiac Registry has indicated no increase in severe outcomes. So that's good news for people with arthritis, Hashimoto's, celiac disease. And remember how many people have taken the vaccine, and none of that stuff is bubbling up. But it's a good point. If you have something unusual, like this girl with the 12-year-old with hives on the knees or something, there's a way you can report an unusual finding. And it's called the VAERS report, V-A-R-E-S, V-A-E-R-S, excuse me, event reporting. And anybody can file one of those. You can get it online and fill the form out and send it in. And the FDA will actually keep a record of all those and see if they can come up with some kind of pattern of these type things. This all becomes public information, by the way. So it's a very valuable report, but if you don't report them, we're never gonna find out about it. You know, maybe there's like hundreds of people who had hives on their knees. You know, wow, that would be, you know, strange and unusual, but you know, it would get added to the list. So I encourage people, if they have an unusual reaction, to go ahead and report it. If they don't know how to do it, or it's appears too complicated, their doctor can help them.
Well, that's great news. Well, I thank you so much, Dr. Murphy, for your time. I wanted to quickly add, if you submitted a question and you did not see it answered in this video, that's likely because Dr. Murphy has previously answered that question in a previous video we've released. So please feel free to check out our Facebook page and check out the other videos we've posted.
Great. And I'm still on WGN every Monday and Friday for now anyway. And I'll take these questions during the middle of the week. Thank you, Katie.
Thank you.